I'm sorry,
yeah,
okay.
Start.
Okay. So I wanted to just collect some informal feedback. The first session today was not so mathematical. It was more the lock picking stuff. Then there was what did I do after that? I talked about viruses and worms and denial of service attacks and more descriptive stuff. What is your preference? I mean, and the earlier part of the workshop, more of the speakers were, it was much more mathematical. Based on your research or your interests, do you have a preference for more mathematical stuff? Yes? From a thing. Yeah, how many want more mathematical stuff? Okay, I think it's overwhelmingly more math. How many don't want, I mean, it's a loaded question. Nobody's going to say I want less math because we have a thing, but okay. So today, my talks are less mathematical. The end, I will try to go into a little bit of math. I'll try to go into something interesting. So it will be this second session too. I apologize in advance. It will be a little bit descriptive. But on the other hand, the one thing I will say in defense of that descriptive stuff is that, in my experience, what is mathematical and what is useful often have a zero intersection. There's lots of stuff that's very useful and doesn't have any math in it. And there's lots of stuff that is very mathematical and it's completely useless. Occasionally you find something that is at the intersection of both, that's mathematical and useful. The stuff that I'll be talking about now, the descriptive stuff, I think it largely falls under the useful but not mathematical category. But it was done by a bunch of mathematicians who used the fact that that it had some origins in math to create some kind of buzz around it and create some barriers to entry for other people. Because people think, oh, this must be some deep math and something. And so from a commercial standpoint, they stay away from it, which is good for somebody who's trying to commercialize it themselves. It has at least that sort of preventive value. Today I'll talk about DNS. This domain name system, I'll go into a little bit of detail about that. It's related to this denial of service attacks. I'll talk about these things called content delivery networks, which is the stuff that I did at Akamai. So Akamai is a content delivery network, so I'll explain how they work. And I'll give some stories about that. And then, towards the end, I'll talk about this thing called guessing secrets that came out of how the CDNs work, and it's related to the DNS system. This guessing secrets has some nice work in that some of the, it's a math problem. It's not directly related to anything useful, but it's a nice math problem that came out of this space, and it uses, it has some nice, math is this very snobbish area. If somebody famous works on a problem, then the problem becomes famous. It's not very clear sometimes if there's anything inherent in the problem itself, but it's just personality or fashion driven. So in that sense, this guessing secrets is very fashionable. There's papers by Rasborov, Noga Alon, and then there's also an application of this list decoding. This Venkatesh and Guruswami's Madhusudan's list decoding stuff. So this guessing secrets, I'll talk a little bit about the connection to list decoding. Tomorrow, I'll prepare a little bit today, and tomorrow I'll give a slightly different set of lectures than what I had originally been planning based on your input, and I will make it much more mathematical. So we'll go into more coding theory and something to do with fully homomorphic encryption, which is more crypto stuff. So for those of you who feel it's not mathematical enough today, bear with me. Tomorrow it might satisfy your need for more math. And for those of you who don't like math anyway, you don't have to come tomorrow. So that'll save you that some time tomorrow. So we'll start with. DNS and CDNs. And as before, I'll maybe at around 12:15, I'll try to give a break for 5 minutes. Okay, so I'm going to talk about Akamai. Akamai was a company founded in the late 90s, around 98, and it had great success initially. It was founded by a math professor at MIT. He was one of my advisors. And his grad student was the main force behind it, the guy called Danny Lewin. The advisor was Tom. So Danny was the main guy, the driving force behind Akamai. It did very well, you know, in the dot-com bubble. It grew very dramatically. It was up to, at one point, it had a market cap of about $35 billion. And then it plummeted just as sharply as it had risen. By around 2001, after 9/11 and so on, it was a shadow of its former self. But then it has sort of recovered. Now it's about a market cap of about $10 billion. It's doing about $1.5 billion in revenue. They've got about 2,000 people, I think. Nearly 1,000 people are in Bangalore. They have an Indian office, and they serve about 10 to 20% of all internet traffic. So something that's very useful in the sense that I'll talk about how. It makes lots of things happen on the internet, things that you're using practically. There is some math in it. It was founded by math professors and so on. But I was in the company right from the beginning, so I know that most of that is marketing hype and not reality. So the math, I don't think, is really essential or intrinsic to the business of the company. But it's good in the sense that, as I said earlier, other people think that there's something deep going on, and so then they stay away from it. Okay, so the way the internet used to stop, and they say www.foo.com, and they want to access the content. Okay, now the problem with the internet is that it's a best effort kind of system. And as you can see, the content from the content provider to the end user, instead of sort of going directly, it may get routed through various networks before making its way to the end user. And the system, it's a federated system. There are a lot of network providers, UNet, AT&T, AOL, so on. And each of them has a network. Network just means they have a bunch of routers and some cables connecting them. And some of them are retailers, so that means they will sell connectivity to people in their homes and offices. Those, they will send them a bill every month and for having some connectivity. And those people, like here, for example, Airtel or somebody like this, you pay them some money every month, and they give you connectivity, which means that they take your packets and they send it to the destination. Now, they typically care about giving good service to the people that they are hosting and the people that they are providing end connectivity to. They are not as concerned about providing very good connectivity to people who are paying customers of other ISPs. Okay, and so they follow this policy called hot potato routing, where they think of this information, this packet, as a potato, as a hot potato, and they just pass it off to the first other person they can find, not necessarily in the direction of where the packet is supposed to go. Okay, so in the US, how many people here have used Traceroute, this internet tool utility called Traceroute? Okay, couple. How many people here know about ping? Okay, so unless the rest of you are not raising hands, those of you who are not raising hands, my guess is that you sort of use the internet as a black box. You just go, you fire up your browser, you say www.facebook.com or whatever, and just check that. Those of you who sort of go behind the scenes or who were from an earlier era, from the 90s or something, you may actually know, you may have used these tools because you may have had to debug it. You may sometimes not get good connectivity or good performance, and then so you may try to run a trace route, see what's going on. You may have called up your ISP and spoken to them about connectivity. You would have done some speed test downloads. You would have seen what time of day. There's some people who are sort of more involved with the internet, and many people just use it as a black box. They just plug in, they have connectivity, they can check their email, and they're happy. Okay, so this talk will be geared towards people who are sort of going into the innards of the internet a little bit, not a whole lot. There's not that much to go into. If you run a trace route, for example, a trace route from the East Coast to the West Coast in the US, you'll sometimes find that the trace route will go through Europe. Okay, so for those of you who don't know what traceroute is, it's there in all your machines. It's a little utility. You can run it. It sends packets to a destination IP address with various time to lives, TTLs. And when the packet dies at a particular place based on its time to live, you get an ICMP packet back saying the packet died there. And then so you know all the hops along the way. Okay. So if you have never done it, just Google for traceroute, try it, you'll get a sense for it. Basically, you can find the path from point A to point B, all the intermediate hops also. Okay, not all, whoever wants to disclose their identity or whoever has a IP address that they disclose or a DNS reverse record, all of those hops you will find out. Okay, now if the internet were very efficient, all those routes between any point, point A and point B, should be like a shortest path. Okay, it's not. So routes on the internet go long, wander, and go from point A to point B through very circuitous routes. That's number one. Number two is that there is no mechanism in the internet for enforcing any kind of goodness. There's this protocol called the Border Gateway Protocol that I mentioned earlier that fixes these routes. People are supposed to advertise true routes. As a network provider, you're supposed to say what your real routes are. And BGP has built within it a shortest path routing thing. It just does Bellman forward and computes the shortest path. But people lie because nobody has an incentive to tell the truth. Okay, so now there's been, again, some work on BGP and mechanism design and things like this. But like I said, there's this disconnect between useful and mathematically interesting. Algorithmic game design, people have done lots of things like this. Nothing gets used. You know, there's really several reasons for it. Actually making something impactful is not a trivial problem. So for these reasons, the internet is sort of a best effort kind of creature. You go to your browser, each time you say www.something.com, you actually have a little prayer in your head that everything should work well. It may or may not. Sometimes the page will download quickly, sometimes the page will load halfway and break, sometimes the page won't load at all. You know, every time your interaction with the internet is a very iffy interaction. It's not like a guarantee 100% things will go smoothly with a certain quality of service. And the main reason is because there are all these networks in the middle, there's nobody to police it. People just send, you know, they do a best effort. They take your packets. If for some reason some router's buffer overflows, something dies somewhere, it can be dropped. And in general, people oversell and under-provision. So they will tell you that they are selling you a 1 gigabit per second link. And they would have sold the same 1 gigabit per second link to 50 other people in your neighborhood. And all of you are being pushed out through one common pipe, which is 1 gigabit per second. So you have 1 gigabit per second from you up to the central office. But from there, the outside, which is what you really care about, 50 of you are sharing the same link. And if 10 other of your neighbors are all downloading adult content, then you know you can't do anything. So this kind of scenario is what we are faced with in the internet today. So this was clearly an issue, and even in the 90s, so Tom, who's this professor of math at MIT, and Danny, they decided, okay, why don't we try to take advantage of this and make a business out of it? And their idea was to bypass all this congestion in the middle of the internet. And they came up with this company, Akamai. So I already mentioned a bunch of problems. You could have latency, loss. You could have jitter. If you're watching some streaming event, you know, sometimes the video will freeze. The audio will continue, sometimes video and audio will be choppy, things happen, and then you know content itself may not be correct. So all these issues happen. And so their idea was, why don't we put boxes at the edge of the internet? So there is a well-developed ecosystem of hosting. So there are lots of companies out there who run big buildings with no humans on them, just racks upon racks of machines. So what you do is you just go to the web and you sign up with some box manufacturer like Angstrom Microsystems or somebody. You know, they'll typically be either an AMD shop or an Intel shop. They are getting motherboards and chips from them. They're assembling it into a little box. These shops will be located somewhere in China. On the internet, you order 500 of these boxes and ask for them to be shipped to the Airtel data center in Gurgaon. So then those boxes will just get shipped. Somebody in that data center will pull the boxes out of the packaging, stick it into racks, you know, earthquake-proof racks, and feed it electricity, and it'll be in an air-conditioned environment. And then you can just SSH in, log in from remotely from outside, install your software and run it. And now you've got a service operating. Okay. So there is a well-developed ecosystem of people who will host your machine in different parts. And Akamai bought a bunch of machines. They got venture capital funding. Then they also raised public capital through doing an IPO. They bought a bunch of boxes and they put it at different places throughout the internet. And then they went to the content providers. They went to the CNNs and the Yahoos and so on and told them, we will prefetch your content and keep it locally. So think of it just like a supermarket, right? Each time if you want to get a fruit or a vegetable or something, milk or something, you can go all the way to the farm and get it. But that, you know, it's not a very practical thing for everybody to be doing. So these people, they've already gone, they act like a supermarket, they have a bunch of machines in a data center, they've already fetched the content and kept it there. And then when you need the content, you just go and get the local copy. Okay, so they charge, didn't charge you any money. You don't notice any change. In your browser, you still say www.something.com, just as before. So for you, nothing has changed. What has changed is that these people have interposed themselves in the middle. They're charging the CNNs and the NBCs and so on money for delivering their content. So they keep a track of all the content that consumers are consuming. They go back to them, give them the bill, and say, you pay us because we have served so much bandwidth for you. Okay. Now, there are lots of issues with this. One issue is, how did these people come here in the first place? They're still saying www.something.com. So www.cnn.com will connect to here. How will they know to connect to these boxes? Okay, so that's an issue. Second issue is, how are you guaranteeing any kind of freshness or customization of the content? You know, just as with the supermarket metaphor, if you bring stuff and keep it from the supermarket, you'd have some expiry date on it. Otherwise, you know, when things are get bad, you may be serving stale content. And also, how do you customize it? You know, different people have different needs, so you have to personalize the content. If you go to, I don't know, my Google or my Yahoo or something like this, that looks very different from person to person. You know, one person's Facebook page is different from another person's Facebook page. Okay, so those are issues. Okay, so this I thought I'll briefly explain how DNS works because I think this might be useful. If you're using the internet, many of you may know already, but those of you who don't know how DNS works, this is actually useful because you're using it daily and it's a very simple directory mechanism, and also it has relevance for this guessing secrets, the list decoding stuff that I talked about, that I'm going to talk about later today and sometime tomorrow. It has some relevance for that. So it's good to just understand how DNS works. Okay, so you go to your browser and you say www.xyz.com. Then what happens is your browser requests the IP address for www.xyz.com. The way it does is it first goes to your browser looks, has a cache. It looks inside and sees if there's a resolution for www.xyz.com. When we say resolution, we want an IP address. So I'm assuming everybody here knows that every network interface on the internet has an IP address, something like, it's a 32-bit address, like 1.2.3.4. Okay, so it requests, it looks inside, then it contacts the operating system. The operating system also has a cache. If it's not in the operating system's cache, then the operating system will go out and contact a local name server. It's called a resolving name server. That local name server is how does it know to contact the local name server? Because the local name server's IP address is embedded inside the operating system. Either it can be sort of hard embedded, like in your /etc/resolve.conf, if you're running a Linux box or something, or if you're using DHCP, if you connect to the network, typically most people use DHCP. Through DHCP, the DHCP protocol, whoever's running the DHCP server, your sysadmin or your network admin, he'll give your machine an IP address. He'll also give your machine the IP address of a name server. And so your machine will contact that name server and ask for the resolution. Okay, and it will be typically some local box in your network. Okay, some people use Google's name servers for, as the resolving name servers. People here, does anybody here know what name server they're using? Or they, most people just use whatever they get from the system. Okay. What about your clock server? Do you know what clock server you're using? No. From the looks on your face, I guess this is primarily a mathematical audience, and people use laptops as black boxes, and they really don't know what goes inside of their machines. That's okay. So then at least maybe I'm saying something of some value. Okay, so it requests this IP address. It talks to DNS. DNS is this directory system, and it returns an IP address, and then your machine contacts that IP address through HTTP port 80 and says, give me, it does a GET, HTTP GET request to that web server, and then that machine gives back the HTML, index.html or something. Okay, so this IP address, this 10.10.123.8 is the IP address of this box. Okay, these are just made up IP addresses. Fine, and then you get the content, and then if there's any embedded stuff in your page, more stuff, then you go out and get those as well. Okay, so you first get a container HTML, and then maybe other stuff that you get because of that, and you go and you keep getting. And these days you have JavaScript, and JavaScript is running on your machine, and that may cause it to go and do a lot more interactions on the web. Okay, so this is how DNS used to work. So how does Akamai come inside this? How does it interpose itself? Does anybody know? First of all, maybe I should ask a basic question. How many people had heard of Akamai before this talk? Okay, so very small number of you. 20% of all the content that you're getting on the internet, streams, you know, stuff from Facebook, stuff from CNN, is coming from Akamai. So you don't even know about it. But that's okay, I mean, you don't know about lots of things that are working for you. You don't know where the vegetables that you eat come from, right? You just go to your store or the vendor and you get it. But there's an infrastructure behind the scenes that's actually doing all this delivery for you. Okay, so again, if you used the internet in the late 90s or the early 2000s, you might have seen when you're downloading content at the bottom, it says www.akamai.com or edgesuite.net or akamaitech.net. Anybody notice anything like that flashing at the bottom as you're downloading? Nobody. Okay. Okay, let me try and ask another thing. How many people here have been frustrated with the internet? Like, they think it sucks? Everybody. Okay. At some point, good. Well, okay, let me ask another basic question. So when you try to download a big file or something, have you noticed that your download will, it'll be downloading, 10 kilobits per second, 11 kilobits per second, 12 kilobits per second, and then again it'll drop 5 kilobits per second, then again it'll start ramping up 6 kilobits per second, 7, 8, 9, then again it'll drop. How many people know why that's happening? Okay, you guys are really good because you just accept whatever the internet gives you. So, you don't have any complaints. Okay, so that's fine, I guess. Okay, so I think this talk will be truly descriptive. I'll try to cut the internet description down. I'll try to move to the guessing secrets and disk decoding because I think the internet is not of great interest to people here. Okay, let me finish with the DNS. So, okay, so the so you contact and you get your content. Question is, how would, if you had to interpose in between, where in this system could you redirect the content instead of connecting to the web server of the content provider? How could you force this person to connect to Akamai? Any ideas? Have this guy serve, have DNS give a different IP. Okay, so now the way it works is, so here I go into some more details on DNS resolution. We went over this in words, but I'll just show it to you in pictures. So we see where in DNS. So I'm expanding the DNS part. In the previous slide, I had this cloud called DNS, and I said that we get the resolution from DNS. But actually what's going on is that, like I said, first it looks at the browser cache, then looks at the OS cache, then talks to your local name server, which also maintains a cache. If it's not there, then suppose you put www.xyz.com, then it's actually www.xyz.com dot. There's a dot at the end here, which we normally never put. Okay, so it's actually the root of the DNS hierarchy is the dot domain, just a single dot by itself. And you go first to a dot servers. And the dot service, then you ask them, can you give me the resolution for .com, .net, and so on. So those guys, for things like .com, they actually have it inside, but other global top-level domains, GTLDs, they may farm you off to a next-level domain. So in this case, since .com and .dot are folded into each other, you'll get the resolution for .com. This guy will reply and say, I don't know where www.xyz.com is, but I will tell you what .com is, and you can go ask them. And then the .com guy will say, I know where xyz.com is. You can go ask the xyz.com guys. And you go ask that guy. That guy will tell you where www.xyz.com is. So it's a hierarchical system. How many people here have used NSLOOKUP or DIG or something like this? Okay, one, two. Okay, it's truly a mathematical audience. Okay, so so companies, you know, they have services out there. Like, how many people here have purchased a domain name at some point? You've never purchased a domain name? Okay, one or two. Okay, so anyway, if you purchase a domain name, somebody is hosting your name for you. You pay that fellow some 30 rupees or something. He'll register your name, your domain name. Suppose you want cpr.com. You can just go on the web, you can sign up, you pay 30 rupees, he'll give you a domain name, and then he's hosting it. That means he's running these DNS servers. So there's some machine guy out there, he's an ISP or typically some DNS registrar service. He'll register it, he'll put all these IP server, he'll serve these names, and he'll also give the resolution back. So you can run your own name server if you want, or you can go get service from a public name server service out there. And that guy will hand back the resolution, and then that will go all the way back into the caches, and it comes with a TTL, or a time to live. So typically the routes have TTLs of a day or 2 days. These will have much shorter TTLs. This is how long you should keep that entry in your cache before going back to the DNS system again. Why not give infinity as a TTL? Sorry? No, not a matter of stale content. I mean, people move servers around. That server may move from this IP address to that other IP address, right? So if you give that thing with an infinite TTL, then that name server will keep it forever. Whenever it wants, whenever anybody in that computer puts www.foo.com, it'll keep going back to that same IP address that it got the resolution for. But things can move, so you want to have a finite TTL. Of course, if you give a TTL of, say, 1 day or something, then in that 1 day, if you move your IP, if you move your machine to your web server from one IP address to some other IP address, then all those people who have it cached, they will not go to the new place until it expires out of their cache. They'll keep going back to the old place. Okay? So then why not always give a TTL of 0? Why not always set the TTL to 0? What is the advantage of setting a large TTL? Exactly. So this thing has a particular cost, right? This, you have to go through this whole system. It's very fast compared to getting a HTTP content, which is very bulky and it's a slow download. DNS happens like that. You don't, you know, sometimes some browsers, olden days, they would actually show that they're doing the DNS resolution. Or if it failed, they'll say lookup failed or something like this. But until that happens, you don't realize that it's happening. It's happening behind the scenes. It's pretty fast. But still, even if it's behind the scenes, you know, if it takes half a second, that's half a second time that, you know, it's a huge multiplier. Oh, everybody's using the internet. If you can shave that half a second, that's a big savings for everybody, right? So you put this TTL, because if it doesn't change and you're storing it, then you can bypass this whole system. You don't have to keep going back to DNS, and that saves time. Okay, so that's why people put a TTL. So it's a trade-off between keeping the address consistent and consistent with reality versus saving time on DNS lookups. Okay, and here, DNS is of different, there are different kinds of records. Here, you're getting what is called an A record, but there are different kinds of records. There's, NX records for mail. So when you send a mail to somebody at foo.com, then the mail server is actually going and looking up foo.com, and foo.com will hand back, you ask for an MX record, it'll give you back the IP address of a mail server, not a web server, but a mail server. And then you connect, you know, port 53 SMTP, you connect to that mail server, and you download the mail or you upload the mail or whatever you have to do, right? So there are different kinds of mail, different types of DNS records. We were talking about A records, which are the resolution between the name and the IP address. Now, we're going to look at how Akamai does it. The way Akamai does it is it has something called a CNAME. Okay, so when you contacted DNS, when you went to the root servers and so on, eventually you're trying to resolve www.xyz.com, you'll talk to xyz.com's name servers. So cnn.com's name servers. Then Akamai goes to cnn.com, they say, goes to cnn.com and say, we will serve your content for you. And in your name server, instead of handing back an IP address of your origin server, please hand back this redirect. Okay, and that's a particular kind of DNS record, just like AA and MX. It's called a CNAME. And a CNAME is an alias or a redirect, and they will redirect to an Akamai name, like www.xyz.8suite.net. Okay? When your name server goes and does this resolution, it'll come across this new name, www.xyz.edgesuite.net. It will then do the same thing. It'll go back to ..net, .edgesuite.net, and so on. And then Akamai will hand back the resolution, hand back the IP, and they will hand back an IP that is optimized for that browser. They will say, okay, this browser is close to Chennai Institute of Mathematical Sciences. I'll hand back the IP address of an Akamai server that's nearby. Okay, so now there's a big issue. How does Akamai know where a browser is located? Because all you get is an IP address. How do you know where it's located? What is good connectivity? How can you know that? Even, is it even something that's knowable in the sense that it's changing all the time. The internet sometimes goes up, sometimes it goes down. Sometimes connectivity to this server is good, sometimes connectivity to that server is good. It's a continuously changing thing. How do you hand back a location that's going to be good for the next foreseeable future when this person wants content? Okay? So think of DNS like a lookup service, like a directory service. You're calling up DNS and saying, I want to get some milk. Which is the best supermarket? And DNS says, okay, go to this supermarket and get your milk. But somebody has to sort of pre-compute the state of all the roads, all the traffic, where there is stock, which supermarket has stock, which doesn't, and sort of hand back an answer at an internet level scale, at a global scale. Okay, so this is a non-trivial problem. Okay, so DNS returns IP of the optimal Akamai server, and computing what is optimal is a non-trivial problem. And then the browser will request that Akamai server for content. So the browser will connect to the Akamai server, which will be close to it. So it will be low connectivity, it will get good service. But then there may be lots of things that this box has to go back to the origin for. So it will go back to the origin, and it will obtain the content from the optimal Akamai server. Now this Akamai server, okay, let me go into one other aspect. So when you go to the supermarket, you're getting some food, bread, milk, other things, right? And the supermarket is not getting the bread and the milk from one farm or something, right? They're going and buying different things from different people, putting it all in the supermarket. Similarly, when you go get a web page, you think you're going to Facebook.com. First of all, you're not even connecting to Facebook.com. Okay, there is no origin server called Facebook.com. Okay, you're going somewhere, that guy will give you a redirect. And then your page consists of various things, lots of little things. There may be some weather, some news, some app, some various things. You are likely, you're going to some content delivery network like Akamai. Most likely it will be Akamai because they're a monopoly player in the space. They have 80% of market share. You're going to some player like that. That guy knows your ID. He goes and fetches all the content from various places, syndicates it all together, packages it up, and feeds it to you. Just like your newspaper, all the content in your newspaper doesn't come from the Times of India or the Hindu or something, right? The cartoons come from someplace, some sports news comes from Reuters. They're just like an assembly. They put it all into one basket and they feed it back to you. So this model of my browser is connecting to a server and getting content, that's only sort of, that is in the olden days, right? One server had all your content. Today, that server is then going and contacting 1,000 other people, and you're not even connecting to the person that you think you're connecting. Somebody is doing all the assembly, putting all the content together and feeding it back to you. So there's a huge ecosystem behind the scenes that's doing all this work. Okay, so now you have an understanding of DNS, you have an understanding of content delivery. This is what a CNAME record looks like. Like I mentioned, content can get assembled different pieces. You have a container page. You will go to Akamai. Akamai will contact Facebook with your ID. They'll say, this is this guy's container page. Fill it with this news from here, that from there. Then they'll contact all these other companies. They'll bring everything together. It all happens behind the scene, and they feed it to you. And it's all happening in like seconds. Because as far as you're concerned, you just do www.facebook.com, and your browser immediately lights up. Okay, but there's a whole lot of activity going on behind the scenes. Okay, now what does let me see how much time I have. Okay, so there's lots of benefits to having a content delivery network like this. Let me tell you some of the benefits, and then I said I would talk about security. So then let me I'll say a little bit about security. Then I'll come back to DNS, and we'll talk about, you know, that guessing secrets problem and why DNS is connected to it. So let me tell you the benefits and then segue into security. So the internet has gotten a lot better because of these content delivery networks. So for those of you who are old enough to remember, you were much more frustrated with the internet in the 90s than you are today. Okay, internet was much worse before. You may not believe it, it's pretty bad today, so you can't believe that it could be much worse before, but it was. Okay, people would connect to their internet, you'd never know, you have connectivity or not, something will work, something will not work. It used to be always a touch and go kind of affair. Now it's still bad, but not so bad. One of the reasons is that these networks have come behind the scenes and they've improved things. So even though before you had to go all the way to Yahoo's website in Sunnyvale, California to get your content. So if there was any problem along the way in the network, some connection, some underground cable, some satellite, some power outage somewhere, something, you won't get your content. Today, you're getting your content from some box nearby. You know, there'll be some data center in Chennai. There are quite a few data centers. And you're getting all your content from there. And so behind the scenes, it's pushing the content and pre-populating it. So you have reduced loss, latency, jitter. You have reduced network congestion. Before, every one of you was going all the way to Sunnyvale, California to get your content. Now you're just going to some box nearby, so you're not congesting that undersea link all the way or the satellite link or something like this. Increased scalability. So let me talk about this scalability for 1 minute. What is the most, I give this talk a few times, so if I think CPR or other people may have heard this talk. So this question won't be a surprise, but for some of you it might be. What is the most viewed live event on the internet? Which do you think is the most popular live event on the internet?
Sports.
Sorry?
Sports.
Huh?
Sports.
No. Any other guesses?
News.
No. So, when I give this talk in the US and I ask people which is the most popular live event on the internet, people say, many people say that it's the Victoria's Secret fashion show that is advertised on Super Bowl Sunday. Because if you look at the demographics of the internet, it's largely a male, young male demographic. Most of the users of the internet are between the age of 15 and 35 and they are male. And males like to watch women in, you know, lingerie or something like this. And Victoria's Secret is this brand that sells lingerie. And they advertise on Super Bowl Sunday, which is the most watched biggest sporting event in the US. And I said the internet is a US-centric phenomenon. So from a traffic standpoint, maybe not number of users, because India has a lot of users, but from a traffic standpoint, in terms of gigabits per second, people say that Victoria's Secret fashion show is the most watched event, because on Super Bowl Sunday, everybody goes, they sit, they watch some two football teams playing on TV on Sunday. Quarter, he would come, and it's still happening, but with Tim Cook instead of Steve Jobs, he would come and he would hold the latest iPod or you know, iPhone or something like this, and he'll be wearing his black turtleneck sweater and talking about the greatness of Apple, and all the Apple faithful will go and open their MacBooks and fire up Apple QuickTime and be watching the show. And that peaks at, you know, close to like 900 gigabits per second. So that's the most watched event. And that event is carried by Akamai. So what does it mean to be carried by Akamai? It means that Akamai, so you know, these happen in this Moscone Convention Center in San Francisco. That's where these, they're physically held. And they'll have a camera, and that'll be capturing the signal. And then that'll be sent to all the Akamai boxes. Now, from one place on the internet, you cannot send so many gigabits per second. There is no place on the internet that has that kind of bandwidth and connectivity to everybody. What they do is they'll have that one stream that will be then, through a hierarchy of Akamai machines, will be duplicated. So there's a tree of Akamai servers. Each server gets a stream from the server above it, and then it duplicates it and splits it to all the servers below it, until it comes to the one single stream comes to some Akamai server here in Chennai. And if you connect to that particular event, then you are getting a stream from there, because that guy is copying it and sending it. So rather than having that, suppose there are 10,000 viewers in Chennai, you won't get 10,000 streams coming all the way from San Francisco to here. So sort of one stream is sent all the way to Chennai, and then it's replicated locally 10,000 times and fed to all of you. So this is something, this is a kind of scale operation that you couldn't do without Akamai. Okay, so people ask, okay, so I never noticed that a system like Akamai came on the internet. If Akamai were to disappear tomorrow, would I be able to tell? You would be able to tell, because the internet will start behaving worse. But then also, from that's from a sort of quantitative standpoint. From a qualitative standpoint, you would have things like the Steve Jobs keynotes or the Apple keynotes you would not be able to support, because there's no other infrastructure that's built to support it. Okay, this reduced cost is basically, at some level, all Akamai is doing is they are a value-added reseller of bandwidth. They're buying up bandwidth from ISPs, packaging it with some smarts, and reselling it to content providers. And so since they are sourcing, Akamai does, you know, terabits per second, they're buying large volumes of bandwidth, they get huge volume discounts, and they're passing some of the savings along to the content providers, because now content providers, they have a bulk buyer in front of them. This is the security aspect, which I was waiting for the last, the fault tolerance and vulnerability. So I have some slides on that, but I'll just give you sort of a small preview. All the important websites in the US, whitehouse.gov, fbi.gov, dhs.gov, Department of Homeland Security, all of these websites are hosted on Akamai. And some very important Indian websites, also the Indian government has given to these CDNs. And the reason is people do these denial of service attacks. Doing a denial of service attack on a single website is easy. If it was just a collection of boxes in some data center, you can keep bombarding it with packets and bring it down. Okay? Just like, suppose, you know, during Tatkal ticket purchase or something, if everybody wanted to shut it down, you know, you can have 500 of your friends all making phone calls or attacking that web server and, you know, taking down that service. But if you really care about it, if you want that service to be up, then you have to take some steps to protect it against these distributed denial of service attacks. And you know, Akamai does that, and I'll talk about how it does that. Before I do that, let me quickly, it's 12:15. Okay, maybe I'll take another, I'll give you a 3-minute break, but I'll take another 10 minutes at 12:20, I'll give you a 3-minute break, and then we'll, because that's a nice break point. Okay, so one key thing in this Akamai business is some user connects to the internet. They come, their browser connects, and they say www.something.com. How do you send them to the correct location? So for that, you need to know where they are located, okay? So how do you find out where somebody is located? And you need to find out where they're located even before they come to you. After they come to you, if you start trying to find out where they're located and all, it takes and you, the whole point of this game is that you want to speed up the internet. The value proposition of a content delivery network to a company like CNN is that we'll make your website faster and more reliable, so that when users come, it'll be a sticky experience, they'll like it, they'll stay there. Because if the web page is bad, if you're downloading it is hard, people click away, they'll go to some other place, they'll stop coming, right? So one question is, how do you know where a person is located? Any ideas how you... IP address, okay, first, you know, an IP address, because of, as you know, because of DHCP and so on, it can be handed out into different parts of the world. It can keep changing also. And also, just knowing the IP address, how do you know where it is, right? Because from 1.2.3.4, how can you tell where it is? Okay, so like I said, in the early days when Akamai was started, started by this math professor, Tom, and he got, he had this idea, and his grad student, and he had this idea, they started this company, then they went out and hired all their friends, because those are the only people who would join them. And so, you know, there are people like me who are working at this company, and I was also sort of like a math grad student. I think because maybe the internet was in a more primitive stage, I knew more about the internet than I get the sense that you guys seem to know, because I think it works so well that you don't need to really understand how it works. But we were pretty clueless. And so one of the first things we did was we decided, why don't we run trace routes to all the IP addresses in the entire world and figure out what the map looks like, where are these IP addresses located and so on. So that's what we did. Running trace routes to the entire world is a big business. This an IP address is 32 bits. 2 to the 32 is like, 4 billion. 4 billion IP addresses is a lot of IP addresses. So we knew this guy, David Filo, who was one of the founders of Yahoo. So we went to David and got user logs for Yahoo, and he gave us all the IP addresses of all the browsers that had shown up in Yahoo's web logs, and we ran trace routes to all of them. And when we did that, people got really upset. So people run firewalls, they run all kinds of security systems on their computer. When they see connections trying to come from outside, then it can trigger an alert. Sysadmins, network admins, and so on, they think somebody is trying to break into the system. And so they got very upset, and they wrote about it in Slashdot. How many people here know what Slashdot is? No, some, okay. So this is this website, it's very popular among tech geeks. We got Slashdotted, and then CERT, which is the security advisory body in the US, they opened a ticket on us, and then Tom had to fly down to DC to talk to the NSA, because people were upset. People are sending emails to abuse at Akamai.com, to CCing Clinton at whitehouse.gov. People went ballistic, trying to convince them, no, we are not doing anything malicious, we are not trying to take down the whole internet, we are just a bunch of clueless people who went out and trace outed the whole world. So that happened one weekend, and it created a lot of fuss, but we learned some important things from that. One of the important things we learned is that, you can't trace out the whole world. People get very upset. You can't even trace out, if you run 1,000 trace outs in an automated way, in a script or something, somebody will get upset, your ISP will get a phone call, you'll get shut down. But there are lots of IP addresses there that don't complain. Okay, so I'll just give you a very high level picture. What we do is we collect all the routes from BGP tables. We collect routes from BGP tables. So I said all the routing information is in this thing called BGP, and that's all public. If you go to a website like lookingglass.com, you can get all the BGP tables you want. You can see the state of all the routing and the information, which autonomous systems, how they are connected, and what IP blocks are there in each autonomous system. An autonomous system is an administrative domain, and the internet can be pretty big. It can span continents and so on. So just knowing an autonomous system doesn't tell you the location, but gives you a good sense for who controls it and how the packets are getting routed. Within an autonomous system, it uses a routing protocol like OSPF or something. It may not use they keep track of their network assets using traceroute and ping. Okay, so they are okay with it. You can traceroute to a router all you want. You can ping a router all you want. You just can't ping an end user. Okay, and what the realization is, Suppose you take an end user like that. Suppose you run a trace route from here, a trace route from here. You'll find that the two trace routes will meet and then sort of walk their way down to that guy. Okay? And the picture is sort of like this. This guy, he's at home. He's got a driveway. And this is a highway up here. And the state of the driveway doesn't give you any information about the decision of whether to send him to this store or whether to send him to that store. Because all that matters is the state of the traffic or congestion on this highway. And so what we realize is there's no need to run a ping or a trace out all the way to the end point. It's sufficient only if you run it to some intermediate point. Once you run it to intermediate point, we see what is the quality of service here versus the quality of service here. And whichever is better, we send it there. And this is a very sort of a high level hack. But there are a bunch of hacks like this, and we can also predict how routes degrade over time, because the routers, they come from two manufacturers, Cisco and Juniper, and these routers, they follow certain queuing disciplines. They follow something called random early drop, where they decide to drop packets if the tail exceeds a certain limit. And so you can tell when a particular route is going bad, because you'll start seeing packet loss mount, and then suddenly the whole route will go into congestion collapse, and then it'll recover again. And so you can tell these things. And so you can predict how the quality of service is going to be. So we make those predictions, and then we do the mapping. I will speed over this, except to tell you, Okay, so what I will say is that basically this is what Akamai is doing. It's running a bunch of probes and measurements throughout the internet, and every 10 seconds it's building a map for every user on the internet, which is the best Akamai server to map him to. Okay, and one question people have is, if Akamai is running all these measurements, can they be making the internet worse? Because all these measurements could be slowing down the internet because it's inducing a lot of traffic. And the answer to that is no. The amount of traffic they induce is very small because they have to pay for the bandwidth for all these packets that they are sending. So it's in their interest to keep that down. So they keep that manageable. It's very small, in the order of a few megabits per second. And they measure the entire state of the internet. So they have a whole sort of full view of the internet, point A to point B, what is the best. And they're constantly measuring this and doing the mapping. And they're providing the service. There's two aspects. There are two aspects that the content delivery network improves, and then we'll go into the security aspect. The two aspects are, one is they bring the content ahead of time and keep it. And second aspect is that they, even for content that cannot be cached. So for example, let's look at something like a tracking number for a package. You have posted a package to somebody and through DHL or FedEx or something, and that package has a tracking number. You're the only person who's interested in the tracking number. Nobody else is, right? So there's no point in caching it because you don't get any reuse out of it. Say you're in Taiwan, you put your tracking number into DHL's website and you want to know where your package is. That tracking number has to be taken all the way to Kansas City, where DHL's FedEx's supercomputers are in some huge underground vault, and then you have to find out, okay, what is the information, bring it back to the user. And there too, Akamai is able to help, because the way they help is, rather than using the raw route of the internet, the BGP given route, they actually bounce off of multiple Akamai machines and take it from Taiwan to Kansas City and back. And this overlay route on top of the internet is much faster many times, often, compared to the underlying raw route. Okay, and this is called overlay routing, and this is another way they add value, especially for stuff that requires serialization. Something that's a database write as opposed to a read. So for example, if you're trying to buy an airline ticket, there's only one ticket, one seat. You cannot distribute it amongst 50,000 Akamai machines because you can't sell the same seat 50,000 times. But there, this overlay routing helps rather than the caching. Okay, so at this point, I think I have covered the CDN aspect of things. We'll move on to this guessing secrets and DDoS attacks. I'll leave you with one thing. There's just a Wall Street Journal front page article that appeared way back in 2001 where Microsoft was being attacked by a DDoS attack, and then they shifted their website to Akamai. I was part of this, and this is notable because Microsoft has their, they use Windows, that's their platform, and Akamai is a Linux shop. Because as a startup, they didn't want to spend money buying operating systems and so on, so they used Linux. And so from a brand standpoint, this was very hard for Microsoft to do, to actually use a system that uses Linux to protect their own websites. And they are, you know, one of the biggest corporations in the world. But they did do that. So the point being that, you know, this kind of technology has some value for security, but moving your website to this kind of a system, it benefits. I'll just conclude with one very small thing. The basic idea is just like the way you protect VIPs, the way you protect, say, the Prime Minister of India. You put a bunch of bullet catchers around him, right? Big guys with wearing dark glasses and close-cropped hair. If somebody takes a shot at the Prime Minister, they'll catch the bullet, and you know, the Prime Minister will be safe. That guy will die, but he's expendable. We can't afford to lose a Prime Minister, right? So it's the same kind of principle for Akamai too. If you want to protect websites, you put all these Akamai boxes around it. You catch all the traffic there. If somebody starts attacking, they end up attacking an Akamai box. They can take down 100,000 boxes. They have 50,000 boxes. It doesn't matter. Traffic still gets served. The actual content doesn't disappear off the web. So that's the basic principle. But we'll talk about it after a 3-minute break. Okay. Okay, so you can spread the machine. So when the attacker thinks he's attacking 1.2.3.4, there can be actually multiple copies of 1.2.3.4, and so the attack will get diffused amongst all those copies. This is the same trick that the root name servers also use. So even though you can have only 13 root servers, and that's because in a single DNS UDP packet, you can only fit 13 resource records. So it's for historical reasons that you can have only 13 root servers. But nevertheless, you can replicate those root servers, those IP addresses, multiple times. So even though there are 13 IP addresses, they actually correspond to something like 500 or more, even close to 1,000 actual locations on the internet. And so similarly, the CDN machines are also replicated. As I mentioned, they form a hierarchy. And interestingly, in some cases, there does not exist a website with a single IP address. So, for example, with whitehouse.gov, there does not exist a website called whitehouse.gov. There does not exist a single IP address. So when you try to resolve www.whitehouse.gov, depending on where you are on the internet, it resolves to a different Akamai machine. So you, as an attacker, could decide to attack that particular machine, so you'll attack that Akamai machine. So anybody who's connected to that Akamai machine or connecting to that Akamai machine, they will experience a loss of service. But then Akamai will detect that and start moving people to other machines. And so then you will also be forced to follow and try to attack other machines. Meantime, the machine that you stopped attacking will spring back to life and start serving traffic again. So the only way to take down a really big network like one of these CDN networks is to have an attack network on the same size. And people do get attack networks. So this picture is just to show my bullet catcher analogy. So these people are shooting bullets, and you put the bodyguards in front of whatever site you want to protect, and the bodyguards can go down, but the site stays up. And and the website itself can be distributed on the CDN completely so that you can't really take down the origin at all. And this is what is done with many of the leading websites. So attacking it is, you know, hard. People are assembling botnets. The bad guys are taking over, compromising various machines, zombie machines, stitching them together into a botnet and trying to launch attacks. But to take down something like Akamai with 50,000 machines, you need a network on the order of tens of thousands of machines. So far, they haven't done it, but again, it's sort of like predicting the earthquake or predicting the takedown of the internet. One of these days, you know, it's an evolving arms race. The bad guys will accumulate enough machines, and they will launch an attack, and they will take Akamai down, and that won't be good for Akamai's business, and it'll also be bad for the internet. Then the good guys will have to come up with some other solution, and so the game will continue. So I'm not saying it will never happen, it just hasn't happened so far. And the two main techniques are this diffusion, they diffuse the attack traffic, and then resurrection. If the attacker moves somewhere else, then the old place where he stopped attacking comes back to life. So through diffusion and resurrection, they are able to protect a lot of the traffic. I mentioned this thing about BGP Anycast. Then I'll talk about hiding using dark address space. The best way to explain this is through an analogy. So suppose your parents have left you home alone when you were a child and they went out, and then when they come back they say, only if I knock on the door you should open the door, you shouldn't open it to any stranger. Then they may have a prearranged signal with you. They may say, I'll come and I'll, you know, knock three times on the door, and then you'll know it's me, and then you should open the door. So same way what we do here, when we hand back IP addresses, we can hand back IP addresses. So we buy a large address space, the CPN buys a large address space, and they hand back certain IP addresses in that space, and that's a function of time and who's the requester. And so if somebody else comes to that IP address at a different time, or if it's a different person at that time, then you can tell, and then you can filter out the traffic. Because you know that legitimate guys, only you had handed this back to this particular resolving name server, nobody else should come knocking at that door. If they come with a different knock, then you turn them away. So we use this kind of trick, it's called sitecloak. The IP address is a function of, the final website address is a function of the time and the requester's IP, and if a different person comes, then we block them. Okay. Okay, so now I've given you sort of the systems level view, and now I'll segue into a bit of math. Here is one fundamental issue with CDN, right? People connect to a website after going through their local name server. So you want to connect to www.xyz.com, you put it into your browser. Then your browser contacts the name server, the name server gets the resolution, gives it back to you, and then you connect to that web server, right? So the mapping is happening at the time of DNS. So the DNS, all it knows is the name server, it doesn't know you, okay? So it says, oh, this is the name server from Institute of Math Science, they're asking for the resolution of www.foo.com, and then on that basis, you know, doing all the mapping and all the tricks and everything, they have to hand back an IP address. But they don't know that it is CPR who is asking for www.xyz.com, or is Isha asking for www.xyz.com. They don't know which specific person. All they know is the Institute of Math Science name server. Okay. So one of the things that we wanted to do at Akamai was build the association of which IP address is connected to which name server. Okay. This is something that changes, but we would like to build this association quickly and have it maintained all the time. So one simple trick to do it is, in the content, you hand back various GIF images. These are like, you know, they're called web bugs. Even now, when you go to some web page, there'll be little invisible GIFs, one pixel GIFs and one pixel things. The advertisers are all placing these to track you. So on the internet, you know, there's no privacy at all. Everybody knows what you're doing. And they fingerprint your machine, they fingerprint your browser. So people think that, or if they use incognito mode or something like this, they're avoiding, they're in stealth mode. Basically, you have zero privacy on the internet. They know exactly who you are, what you're doing very well. But people like to have their illusions. And In one sort of earlier technology they would use was this web bug technology, where they would put a little one pixel GIF and try to see, if you downloaded it, then if you downloaded it from Walmart.com and then you downloaded it from Target.com, you could tell this where that this person had bought something at Walmart, they bought something at Target, and then you can track that person across multiple websites. So I'll mention this trick that we can use similarly to do the client name server mapping. Before that, I'll tell one small story since I have 15 minutes. I'm going to do this fully homomorphic encryption tomorrow. Do people know this Target story? Did it make the news in India? So there was this story in the US that hit the news media around August, September last year. The story goes like this. Some father came into a store in Minnesota, a Target store. Target is a brand. It's a big store like Walmart. They sell lots of things. It's a supermarket. And he said, you're sending all these coupons to my home, addressed to my daughter, and they're all for diapers and baby formula and food and things like this. And my daughter is only in high school. You guys should stop this. This is, doesn't make no sense. So then the store manager said, oh, I'm very sorry, but, it comes from Target headquarters. It's not coming from this particular location, but I'll look into it and find why we are sending coupons for formula and diapers to your daughter. So then the father goes away, and then the store manager files a complaint with headquarters. And then a month later, the store manager calls the father, and he says, we figured it out. There was some bug. We are very sorry. We apologize for this sending those coupons. And then the father says, oh, no. There's no need to apologize. It turns out that my daughter was indeed pregnant, and just that you guys seem to know more about my daughter than I do. There's no need to apologize. So this is the news media, because people in all these news stations and magazines and all, they were writing, how did Target know this girl is pregnant before the father knew that the girl is pregnant? So the reason is that in the stores in the US, they have cameras. And so these cameras are very good. At a distance, they can do facial recognition and everything. And they build up these huge databases. You go into one store, they know at another store that you went in at this time. They build a very good profile of you. But more importantly, they have very good data mining software. They are able to tell, for example, they know that if you buy certain kinds of oils or lotions or perfumes, or not perfumes, or certain kinds of things, lotions mostly, that don't have any smell, then you are likely to be pregnant, because pregnant women get turned off by certain smells. They also know that if you buy certain vitamins and so on, that maybe because you're pregnant, you're buying those vitamins. And so apparently they know this, they build this profile, and they target you based on that. They'll send you coupons for this, because they know that that's a very critical period. If they catch you during that pregnant phase of buying diapers, then you get locked into that particular brand and that particular thing, because your baby will not be okay with another formula because it likes the taste or whatever. So it's very important to capture that market at that point. Then you have that for a long period of time. You can keep selling into that business, selling to that customer. And so what they do is they do target, but they don't target the customer so directly. They will send a bunch of coupons for lawnmowers and barbecue grills and backpacks, and in between they will slip the coupon for baby formula and diaper and all this, because they know that if you feel that you're very targeted, that you will get upset. So they don't want to make it so creepy and that they're watching you all the time. They'll pretend they're not watching you, but they are really watching you all the time, and they'll slip in all those coupons. And so the store manager was actually calling to apologize about that bug. So that software hadn't worked properly, and it had just sent all the targeted baby food formula coupon instead of hiding it in other places. And so he, of course, didn't position it that way, but that was what he was really apologizing for. And so one aspect of these one-pixel GIFs and so on the internet too, if you look, you can, a lot of people turn off ads. How many people turn off their ads? Like, do you use Adbus, something like this? Okay, a few people. Most of you are having ads, whether you're looking at them or not. You will be surprised how much effect that ad has on your psychology without your knowing it. You think you're ignoring them. it's totally not true. It has a huge impact on your behavior. You go into a store and you want to buy a computer, and sort of unbidden, the word IBM comes to your mind or something, because you know IBM buys a whole lot of advertising on the internet. And so there's a lot of this kind of one pixel GIF tracking. There's a lot of this ad stuff being purchased. So we could use the same technology for doing the client name server match. And here's a simple trick you could do. In somebody's web page, suppose their IP address is, I said it's 32 bits, okay, 0 to, okay, I should have 31 here, forget this, or 1 to 32. I have 32 bits, and each bit is a 1 or a 0 or whatever. I can put in their web page, I can put a bunch of 1 pixel GIFs, JPEG images, GIFs or JPEGs, which can be set to 1, 0, so on, depending on that person's IP address. Okay, so the web server, on the fly, it can construct these, put them into the web page. Then, because these images are embedded in the web page, that user's browser will then again go back and try to resolve each of these names. When it tries to resolve each of these names, it will go to DNS. So in DNS, we'll see 01102131, like this. And then we can just read off these bits, and from that, we'll know the IP address of the user. Okay, so this is a standard trick that we were doing, and to find the client name server matching, is this clear, the trick that we do? Basically, on the web page, we put a bunch of names. Those names are tied to the IP address of the user. To fetch the content corresponding to those names, the browser will have to go back to DNS, and then when they connect through DNS to Akamai, we'll know what the IP address is. Okay, now the problem is that you could have multiple clients using the name server, same name server. Like there could be three of you or four of you or two of you using the same name server and at the same time. So even if you put zero TTLs on these, it could be the two different people could be end up requesting 1_0.jpg. Actually, it wouldn't be two different people coming to Akamai, it will be two different people going to the DNS. And because it's within that zero TTL, because it is trying to do the resolution, and before it could answer, somebody else came, it'll hand back the same resolution to both. So now we don't know whether it's coming because of this guy or because of that guy. So there are two different end users, who could generate the same set of answers. Okay, so this we formalize in the following game. This is the problem of guessing secrets. Okay, so let me just abstract it for you. Since you're all mathematical people, and unlike most of the world, which finds it hard to understand mathematical problems, but they understand the internet very well, you people probably understand abstractions very well, but find it hard to understand the internet. So here's a simple abstraction. Let's go with k equal 2. Okay. So there's this simple game called, let me start with k equal 1. There's a simple game called 20 questions. You think of some person, place, name, or something. I'll ask you 20 questions. You just answer yes, no, and I have to find out what you're thinking of. In Boolean terms, we can think of you have some bit string, n bits, and I ask you questions, and you have to answer yes or no from using that string. And based on that, I have to figure out what string you have guessed. If you have only one string of, say, n bits, how many questions can I ask and find out? N. Trivial, right? What is your first bit? Is your first bit 1? Yes or no? Is your second bit 1? Yes or no? Good. Okay, that's very easy. Now, people then complicate it one level. They say, you got a bit string, and maybe you can lie. Okay, so you can, instead of answering correctly yes or no, you say some amount of lies. So some of the bits, some of the questions, arbitrarily, adversarially, you choose to not give the right answer. Okay, then it's fairly simple again, and you know, maybe you can give this a homework problem. You can do this using coding theory. You just take a code of the right rate, and you can tolerate a certain amount of errors, because what unique decoding does is just, it fixes errors, right? So if you say that you have a 5% lying probability, on 5% you can give lies, then you take codes that have distance at least 10% far enough from each other, you can uniquely decode to one of the codes, and you can figure out what string the other person has. Is this going too fast? Do people know what codes are? Yeah? Do people, have you seen 20 questions with lice? How many people here have seen 20 questions with lice? Okay, so I am going a bit too fast maybe. Okay, so why didn't you take this as a homework problem then? I have a bit string of length n, and let's assume some percentage p, p percent I answer with, I lie. Okay, and I don't have any consistency. I may lie on any p percent of the questions you ask me. How many questions do you have to ask me to figure out the right answer? What string I have? Okay, this is the guessing with the. And I'm going to ask you questions. I'm going to ask you, is the first bit yes, is the first bit no, whatever. And okay, let's even make it simpler. You're allowed one lie. You have an n-bit string, you can lie once. How many questions do I ask you to figure out the n-bits? Okay? So one simple trick is I can ask you, say, each question three times. I can ask you, is the first bit zero? Is the first bit zero? Is the first bit zero? Then I can take majority on those three. You can only lie once. So I'll get the right answer. I can read off all the things. I can do something even cleverer. I can do it in 2k plus 1, where I can just ask you, the first question, is it true? Is the first bit zero? Is the first bit zero? And if you give me inconsistent answers, then only I ask the third. Otherwise, I keep going. But basically what we're doing is error correction. This is just unique error correction. I can take a code, and one out of n bits is a very low rate. I can actually get, basically, here you are doing the 2k plus 1, 2n plus 1 questions. You can actually get 1 plus epsilon n for any epsilon. Okay. Basically, so you can actually solve the general case. I think it comes out to something like n over 1 minus h of p, where h is the entropy function of, that is the blow up that you need to. You need to support that kind of code, and then you can do it. I'm sort of jumping ahead. If you want a simple homework problem, just do this. Try to do the following question. I have n bits, a string of n bits I'm thinking of. You can ask me questions. If I always answer the truth in n questions, you can find out my n bits. If your answer allowed one lie, then how much questions do you need? And the answer is 1 plus epsilon n for any epsilon. Try to get the solution. Okay? As an example, just very simple. Now I'm going to move to something more complicated.
What is epsilon?
Your epsilon will be a function of n. But for any constant epsilon. You can get 1.1n, you can get 1.001n, you can get anything, as n growing large. Yeah? Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so now we're going to move to a separate question. I have two n-bit strings. I don't have one n-bit string, I have two n-bit strings. Think of this as the two users using the same name server. Okay, I have two n-bit strings. You can ask me questions. I may choose to answer using this string or that string. Okay, so it's my choice. I'm not going to lie, but I'm going to answer. Sometimes I'll answer using the string, sometimes I'll answer using that string. That's my choice. You have to come back and say, what are the two strings that I have? Okay. Now note that this question is not well defined, because what if I always answer using this string and never use that string? Then how can I even tell what other string I have? Okay. So first make the question well defined. That itself is a nice exercise. It's a small exercise. Okay. If I have two strings, what is the maximum amount of information you can extract? Every time you ask a question, I have to answer. Okay. I can't keep quiet. But what is the maximum amount of information you can extract about the two strings that I have? So a claim is you can narrow me substantially. You can tell that I have a certain collection of possible two strings. Okay, so figure out what exactly you can tell. And secondly, do it using the least number of questions as a function of n. Okay. Yeah, you can do any question you want, as long as it's a 0-1 question. Okay, you think about it. So first, you will observe that. So every question is just a Boolean function from the set of all strings to 0, 1. You don't have to complicate the statement of your questions. It's just some Boolean function. Secondly, we will see, and we'll see this tomorrow, linear Boolean functions are sufficient. You don't need nonlinear functions from up to constants. We don't care about constants. Maybe using nonlinear Boolean functions, you can improve the constants. But in computer science, we do this big O notation business, right? We just sweep, because we can't do all that fine detailed math, we just sort of sweep it under the rug and call it big O. Under that regime, you can sufficient to ask linear questions. So in other words, exactly like over GF2, you take this string that you have, your question can just be another bit vector of n bits, and you ask for the GF2 sum. That means bitwise product and XOR over the sum. Right? You know what I'm talking about? When I say linear over GF2. Okay. Okay. So, sorry? Yeah. You cannot, your question cannot refer to two strings. Your question will just ask of a string. It's the guy's prerogative to pick this string or that string. So as far as you know, you don't know that there are even two strings. You just ask questions about strings. He then chooses to answer based on one or the other. So you can't make any reference to two strings. Let me see. I'm close to time. So tomorrow I'll talk about list decoding. I'll just say a few words. There's this, how many people here have heard of decoding, Shannon-style decoding? Okay, some number of you haven't. How many of you have heard of list decoding? Okay, a few of you. Maybe then tomorrow I'll up the level and talk about, but I'll also cover what list decoding is, so at least you know what I'm talking about. I prepared homework because this is a workshop. I thought I should prepare homework. Here's one nice question, sort of related to this coding and everything. This is this hat problem. This is an old problem. It's on the internet. I'll state the problem. If those of you who know it, there's not much value. But those of you who don't know it, it's a very interesting thing. But please don't Google it on the internet, because it's on the internet, and so you can easily solve it. For those of you who know it, I'll give you the axiom of choice version of it, the infinitary version, which is very cute. So this hat problem is related to this list decoding and to this guessing secrets problem. Okay, so it's not disconnected. I'll do the connection tomorrow. But let me state this problem for now. It's a nice homework problem. There's a king. He puts three hats on three subjects. Each hat is chosen uniformly at random to be black or white. A subject can see, I forgot the word see all hats but her own. So you can see the other two people's hats. Then simultaneously, some non-empty subset of the subjects must speak up, and everybody who speaks up, each, must say the correct color of her own hat, else they will all be put to death. Okay? So there's three people. The king comes, flips a coin, puts a black hat, flips a coin, puts a white hat, flips a coin, puts a white hat, okay, puts three hats. Everybody can see the other people's hats except their own hat. Then some number of people have to speak up. If everybody keeps quiet, the king kills them all. Some number of people have to speak up. Whoever speaks up has to say the correct color of their hat. Okay? How many people have heard this problem before? Okay, a fair number of you. Okay, for those, I'll give you a variant which you may or may not have heard of. For those of you who haven't heard of it, are you clear about the problem? Okay, so naively, you think you can only do probability half. The best strategy seems to be two people keep quiet, one guy just randomly says black or white. Okay, what does he know the color of his own hat? And then, of course, with probability half, he'll be correct, they'll all live. With probability half, they'll all die. Correct? But the amazing thing is, you can do better than probability half. Yeah, ahead of time they can do whatever they want. They can fix the strategy ahead of time. Once the strategy is fixed, then the king comes, puts the hats, then they can't talk. Sorry? No, time, there's only one clock tick. He puts the hats, there's one epoch of time, so they can't do communication based on waiting and stuff like that. No. Ahead of time they can prepare whatever strategy they want. So they will prepare a strategy, and in fact the question is to come up with a strategy that beats half. Okay, so you can always come up with a strategy of half, right? Ahead of time they can say, suppose the three people are A, B and C. A, B and C can decide. B and C will keep quiet. A will only talk. A will just say black. Okay, this can be a strategy. In this strategy they will survive with probability half, because half the time A will get black, he'll be correct. Half the time he'll be wrong, they'll all die. Claim, the question, can you do better, it's a claim is you can do better than half, and the question is what is a strategy that does better than half. Okay, interesting thing is that you can, this thing not working, for in the case of n people, you can get arbitrarily close to one. Okay, with probability one, they can all survive. So the more people there are, it seems to be a harder coordination problem. Counterintuitively, you can survive with probability one. Okay, and for those people who had heard of this problem, here is a question which let me state it, and then if you have not heard of it, if you heard of that one also, then let me know. Now the king has an infinite number of subjects. Okay, so this is mathematics, okay, so this is, don't ask how can a king have infinite number of subjects and so on. We don't do useful things, we just do mathematical things. So king has infinite number of subjects, and you come and you flip a coin for every subject. The king does, he puts hats. Okay, now the subjects survive if, let me get this right. For the subjects to survive, an infinite subset of them have to speak up. Okay, an infinite subset have to speak up. No, actually, let me stay. Okay, for the subjects to survive, all of them but a finite subset have to speak up. And let me put it even more simply: all but a finite subset can stay silent or get their hat color wrong. Okay, this is how survival is defined. You have the subjects, all of them but a finite number can stay silent or get their hat color wrong. Otherwise, if an infinite subset stays silent or an infinite subset gets it wrong, then all of them are put to death. Question is, what is the probability that the subjects survive? Okay, have people heard this version of the question, the infinitary version? Interestingly, if you assume the axiom of choice, okay, this is really interesting. If you assume the axiom of choice, then with probability one, everybody can survive. Infinite number of people can all get their hat colors correct with probability one. Is this counterintuitive or not? Right, everybody's got a random hat. What information do you get by looking at other people's hats? You have no information. Your own hat could be black or white. But an infinite number, assuming the axiom of choice, all but a finite number, will get their hat color correct. That's fascinating. And if you assume the negation of the axiom of choice, because as we know, axiom of choice is independent of the ZF axioms. If you assume the negation of axiom of choice, then with probability zero, people will survive. So this is a very nice question. It seems like a very concrete question, but the answer depends on your axiomatic assumptions. Right? We all play the game assuming ZF plus axiom of choice, but there's no reason, I mean, the world could be a ZF plus negation of axiom of choice. Okay, so for the anyway, that's the infinitary version. If you want to think about that, that's very cute. Or the finite version, just try to beat for three, and then see if you can generalize it for general n, and then you'll see the connection with coding theory straight away. If you know what codes are, And then tomorrow we'll talk about guessing secret. Sorry? Bound for 3, I think you can do 3 quarters. I'll have to sit and work it out, but I think you can do 3 quarters. Okay, thanks for your time and patience. Any questions?